Hey, video editors, if you've ever wanted to create a Polaroid effect of an actual moving video, in the next few minutes I'll show you how to do that in Adobe Elements version 13, Premiere that is. A couple of my YouTube subscribers asked for this, so I thought I would be a nice guy and show you how to do that. So what this effect looks like is I've got some belly dancers here, and I'll play this small example. So that was it. You've got a very short video that plays, and then on top of it, there appears to be like somebody taking a picture and that picture flying across the screen. So what that looks like, just once again, is as I dance my cursor along, you see the video stop, a Polaroid gets taken, it zooms, it pans, it rotates, it fades, and then you go back to the actual video itself. Just a couple of ways that you could do this across a video, or you could have the same effect on a still image itself. This tutorial here is just how to do this over a video. So I'm going to show you how to do this. So first, let's go back to ground zero and we delete everything, and I'm going to show you how to do this from the ground up. So if you're not familiar with the interface, if you don't have it set up this way, I recommend working in expert mode. In fact, I don't think you can do this any other way. Be familiar with the Applied Effects tab. And the effects at the very bottom of your screen, we're going to be spending a lot of time in these particular areas. So I'm going to go to my project assets. I've already got this video in my assets, so I'm just going to go ahead and drag it on top of my timeline. Now, you could probably drag this on video 2, 3 if you wanted to, if you already have something on video 1. I'm just going to drag this on video 1 just because I have nothing else in my video. Let me zoom this down a little bit. I don't need all of this extra stuff on here. So let's find a good place, a good stopping point where we could take a sort of a snapshot. Maybe right where she's kind of flipping her hair. That could be a good shot right about here. Of course, we have to find a place where it's in focus. Maybe right here where she's flipping her hair. That might be a kind of a neat shot to act like you're taking a picture of that, and then have that do the effect that I just showed. So there's not an automatic way of doing this in Premiere Elements, so we're going to go do this through brute force. So what we're basically going to do is we're going to cut the video, put a still frame in there, and then we're going to fondle that still frame to get the effect that we want. So when you get your cursor to the right spot, go to the Tools menu, hit the Freeze Frame, and enter the time. I found 2 seconds for my videos tends to be good enough, and then hit the insert movie. So what happens is it splits the frame, adds a still image in there, and then it picks up right where the video left off. So let's go ahead and zoom in on our timeline just a little bit more so you can see things a little bit easier. All right, so just to give you an idea of what all of these, you've got the video a bar up here and the audio. If you expand this little arrow, you can actually see some of the clips to see kind of what you're dealing with, and you can also expand the audio to see the actual waveforms here. We're going to get into what these little yellow bars are in just a few minutes, so right now we can work with these things collapsed, but just kind of familiarize yourself with that that UI there. All right, so what we're going to do is I'd like to take this still frame here, and I want to put borders around it, and I want to zoom it and pan it and do all that kind of fun stuff and rotate it. But if I modify this one here, it affects the entire clip segment here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy this to the clipboard, Control C. I'll go to the end of my video, I'll Control V, and I'm going to take this copy and put it right back on top of the other one. Now, the reason I went to the end of the video here, that if you try to Control C and Control V, sometimes it does some very weird things. It puts it next to it, it splits some frames, you know, basically wherever your cursor is, it will try to insert that control or that paste, and it's kind of a tough thing to deal with. Now that I have a video, or an image on top of an image, I can do whatever I want to the top one and retain the image below it. So obviously, if you haven't figured it out by now, we're going to take the top one here and we're going to scale it, dance it around, and do whatever we want. So, and notice how the bottom one bleeds through. So how these renderers work, it renders the top one on video 2, and then it renders what's below it on video 1. So there's where we're going to clip and crop and pan and zoom our image that is on video 2. So let's undo this to get this back to its default size. So there's going to be a couple of effects that you need to use to get this effect to work. So I'm going to go in my effects tab, and I'm going to find something called a clip, which is not a crop. Make sure you get the right one. Let's go to all of our little, effects here. Let's go find the clip and drag it on top of your upper image. Then we have to use something called a 4-point garbage map. And I know this may not make a whole lot of sense now, but it will in just a few minutes. And let's go find our 4-point garbage map. You might think that you could use the crop, but it won't work. It works on the whole video. We want it to work on just a segment or a portion of this video. Now you might see that this thing does some squirrely results up here. I've got this sort of trapezoidal shape. I've got these black borders around here. We got to fondle our settings or our effects to get it to work just right. Now, depending on the order that you added your effects makes a huge difference. The clip has to be above the 4-point garbage map. If you don't get it right, you can just drag one, on top of the other to get your clip above your 4-point garbage map. So depending, you can drag and drop things around. So notice I have this 4-point garbage map above the clip. So what happens is because the way the renderer and these effects work, I can no longer see the image below it. That's why you have to have the clip above your 4-point garbage map. So step number one, let's go ahead and turn our garbage map off for right now. And let's go to our clip and let's sort of clip in our clip. So these little sliders here allow you to do just that. So if you're not familiar with this user interface over here, just go to your applied effects and you're going to have motion, which is on by default. Opacity you get by default, and the clip and the 4-point garbage map are those ones that I just added. So go to your little top clip, and we're going to move this into about here. You can dance these little sliders back and forth. You can move the top down a little bit, and I'm going to kind of frame my image in here to kind of give an effect of a Polaroid shot. You know, maybe this is good enough. Just as an example, I'm not going to get real precise with these numbers. These are percentages here, this 41%, which kind of a useless number. You can hit this little gear button up here, and it gives you pixels, so you can measure the pixels from either end. Unfortunately, it makes it kind of hard to get an exact value. If you want to come in, make a border around this thing 50 pixels or 60 pixels, you can't just type 60 in the left and right because your image is probably not centered. So you're going to have to kind of fight with this thing and play with it to get the right framing on your image. Once you have that done, I'm going to go back and turn my 4-point garbage map back on by clicking the little eyeball. And notice what this thing does is this sort of crops out everything outside of your or inside of your 4-point garbage map. So if I click in this little title bar here, I get these little drag corners, and I can drag this image in, or sorry, this corner in, and this corner here. Basically, this is a poor man's way, because there's not a good way, to create a border around your image. Now, normally I would sit and fondle these numbers here like I probably will right now. I'll enter 740 for this, 740 for this one. I'm just picking random values I think are going to look good. And I have no idea how this is going to look, so we'll just kind of, maybe we'll get lucky here. Add a couple more values here just to kind of give it some precise control of these settings here. Maybe 700 in this last one. Now, you can't use my numbers here. You're going to have to pick your own numbers or your own values to get the frame size just right. If you've ever used an old Polaroid camera, for you young buckaroos, this is a cool little camera that your parents carried around that you could take a picture. Out would pop the picture on a cute little postcard type size thing. And you wait about 60 seconds and the image would show up. And they were cool back then, but nowhere near the cool digital stuff that we have today. They weren't black borders, they were white. So let's go back to our clip side of things, and let's change our fill color to white. You can change this to really whatever you want. Now that looks a little bit more like a kind of a Polaroid shot. Now, the borders aren't right, I know, but you get the idea of how to create a border around an image. Now, why did I go through all this pain here is because now that image on video 2, I can move this, do whatever I want, and the stuff below it will stay. So, for example, let's go to our motion tab, or motion effect, I should say, and I've got control over the position, the scale, the rotation. So if I change the scale, I can move that in, I can change the rotation, get all kinds of fun effects here. However, if I change that, it's for the entire clip, and that's not really that exciting. What I want it to do is kind of change over time. So let me go back to where we were. Rotation, say, 0, and the scale 100 to get it to back to where it was. And now we're going to turn on some keyframes to control this position and scale and stuff over time. So if you've ever messed with this little show hide keyframe, now's the time to activate that, and you get this little secondary timeline window that allows you to dance your cursor back and forth just in that selected clip. Now, if you inadvertently select a different clip, like this one over here, all of that goes away. If you go back to your motion, you don't have the stuff that you set in here. You've got to go back to that original clip that you just selected. So sometimes you deselect things inadvertently. Make sure you have that clip selected to apply the effect to that clip. So let's go back and expand our motion. And let's move our cursor to the very beginning. You could also hit page up to do that. Scale, I want to keep to 100%, so remember that by hitting the scale button. I want to remember the position as well and the rotation. Somewhere around the end of the video, I want the rotation to be, I don't know, some convoluted angle, and I want the scale to be a real blown up type scale here. So what happens over time, it zooms and it scales as your cursor is going across that timeline. Other things that you can do, you can work with the position. Let's, for example, I've remembered this position by that small keyframe. Maybe at the end, I want the position to be down a little bit. I can change this to say, 200. I'm just going to pick some random values here. 800 to get the thing to pan, zoom, and scale all at the same time. So now what happens is, you can just imagine you're watching a video here, somebody stops to take a picture, and they throw the thing away because they're done. They're ready to go back to their video. That's kind of the Polaroid effect here. Now, I know, again, the border is not really that good. It's not very symmetric and whatnot, but you can play with the numbers all day long to get the right look and the feel that you want. Now, having it just cut out like that's kind of boring. Let's go ahead and change the opacity so it fades out. How you do that, if you haven't guessed by now, you expand, let's collapse our motion, go to our opacity. Same thing here at the very beginning. I want it to be 100, so let's remember that by hitting this small add keyframe. At the very end, I want it to be 0. So you can hit a keyframe here and adjust it, or just adjust it, the opacity down to 0, and it adds that keyframe for you automatically. So what happens is it zooms, it pans, it scales, and it fades out. But it's fading out a little bit too fast here. I want it to fade out sort of right about here. So go to this part in your timeline, add a keyframe, and just bump the opacity back up to 100. Now it preserves that 100 until that keyframe is hit, then it transitions down to, say, 0. Now that is one way to adjust your opacity, the time of your opacity and when it happens. If we close all of this down, and we expand our video clip by this arrow at the far right left-hand side of your screen, there's these little arrows. These are also your keyframes for your opacity. So if you want to change it, you can just drag it right in this little keyframe window down here and play, have all kinds of fun by moving that around. You can also hold your finger on the control key and add, sorry, is it the shift key? I always forget. It's control. Hit the control key and add some more of these keyframes here to get it to do all kinds of weird things, which this is probably an ugly effect, but you get the idea on how you can play around with these keyframes here. This could also be done in the dialogue that I just showed you. This is just another way that you can modify the opacity. Now, the one thing that I don't have on here is typically when people stop to take a picture, you have the sound of a shutter. So I did download from somewhere a shutter sound, so I'm going to drag this onto my soundtrack track, and then some kind of, a jet screaming or whatever this sound is to kind of make it sound like that I just took the picture, and it's flying across the screen. So let me play this and you can kind of listen. Nah, I don't know if I like that, but you get the idea. All right, so the one thing I don't like is how the video fades out to a still image behind it. I want the video to start playing. So what you can do is grab the endpoint of your underlying image and just drag its endpoint in until, you know, you get to the spot that you want, and when it starts to fade, then the video picks back up. It's a little bit more of a more of an animated effect. Other things that you can do, just a couple last minute edits here. Let's go to our soundtrack, is our little jet screaming or whatever it is. I don't like how it just starts from sort of a loud and stays loud. As you remember from the opacity editing, just hold your finger on the control key at a couple of these key points inside of your sound, and then drag them down to pan or control the volume, that is, from loud to quiet and so on and so forth. So let me stop and play that. I don't know if I like that that jet screaming engine effect there, but you can put whatever sound that you want in there. So that's kind of the Polaroid effect for how to use a Polaroid effect in an actual video. I'll probably create another video, so sub me if you want to see it and come back to my channel, and I'll show you how to create the same exact effect if you're on, say, a still image where you maybe you're flipping through a photo album and you want to look at this photo and throw it away. Look at that photo and throw it away. Look at this photo and throw it away. Kind of multiple things. I'll show you how to do that that effect. So stick around. There's more to come. I hope you'll learn something here. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to comment.